How many objects can you see? Now? 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 So what changed? Why were you able to see the objects first and then suddenly you could see lesser and then none? I'll come back to this later, but for now, let's start with sight and light. We humans have five senses that we rely upon to get all the information we need. And sometimes information that we don't really need. These senses are sight, for which we use our eyes, hearing, for which we use our ears. We smell through our noses, taste by using our tongue, and touch, where we mostly use our fingers, but we can use almost any part of our body to get a sensation of touch as well. Although all the senses are important, but 80% of our sensory information comes through our eyes. Because think about it, we see a lot more that we can touch, hear, smell, or taste. So the question is, how do we see the objects around us? So now let's go back to the beginning experiment, but I'm sure you know the answer by now. We see objects around us because of the presence of light. But then we saw that when we switched off the light in the room, we still saw some objects like the glowing fancy glasses and the friendship bands and the small torch. And then we switched off the torch light and we still saw the other glowing objects. Once they were removed, we didn't see anything at all. So what do we learn here? Objects can be luminous or non-luminous. Luminous objects generate their own light and therefore can be seen by themselves. In this collection, the luminous object was the torchlight. Other examples of luminous objects are the sun and other burning stars, firecrackers, lightning, fire, bulb, car lights, city lights, and the collective lights of cities you can also see from space. Non-luminous objects don't generate their own light. They can only reflect light, therefore they can be seen only if there is some other source of light for them to reflect the rays. The other objects in the collection were all non-luminous. So most things that we see around us are non-luminous objects, including cars, house, furniture, humans, earth and moon, and billions of other things. Is the torch a luminous body? No, it's not. Only the bulb is luminous, and that too when it's lit. Same thing with a mobile phone. It's not luminous. It's only the screen, and that too only when it's lit. Then it becomes luminous. I spoke about most of the things on the table, but are you thinking what I'm thinking? What were the glowing things? Where do they fit? Now, this is not part of the syllabus, but then science is much more beyond the syllabus as well. And this part was interesting, so I want you to know a little more about it as well. There are some objects, chemicals, even plants and animals that can absorb strong or ultraviolet light when they are exposed to it. And when there's no light, then these objects start glowing, releasing absorbed light. The friendship band is different. It has a chemical reaction that emits light and therefore it glows. So this kind of self-luminous glow could be phosphorescent, which is also known as glow in the dark, or radioluminescent, caused by radioactive reactions, or bioluminescent, which many plants and animals have. Coming back to the syllabus, when light from a luminous object falls on non-luminous objects, they become illuminated, meaning they can now be seen. This means light has to travel from the source and hit the object and then deflect off the object to reach our eyes so that we can see it. This process of light reflecting off an object is called reflection of light. Let's understand a little more about it. Light is emitted from a luminous object as rays of light, and it is emitted in all directions from the light source. Let us look at one single ray of light. Light travels in a straight line, and a ray of light can be defined as this straight line path along which light travels. Let's take a single ray of light and hit it on a mirror from any angle. And using that, let me introduce the main terms we'll use in these experiments to explain the laws of reflection. The ray of light coming out from a light source is called incident ray. The point where it hits the mirror is called point of incidence, and the reflected ray beyond this point of incidence is called the reflected ray. And most important is something that you can't see here, and that is the normal. The normal is a line drawn from the point of incidence, which is perpendicular to the surface of the mirror. So I'll do an interesting thing to understand normal better, and then we'll go to the next part of understanding the laws of reflection. Let me bring the ray of light at 90 degrees to begin with. Now that the incident ray of light is along the normal, currently the angle of incidence is zero with the normal. Now if I start taking it this side, the angle keeps changing. And if I start taking it to the other side, the angle once again is changing. But did you notice one thing? The incident ray and the reflected ray maintain the same angle on either side of the normal. So now let me stop this experiment at one angle and let's dive in a little more to understand it better. Let's call the incident ray AO, meaning the light is coming out from A and hitting the mirror at the point of incidence that we call O. The reflected ray can be called OB because it's reflecting from point O and heading towards B. The normal we'll call NO because it's touching the mirror at O. Now the angle between AO and the normal NO is called the angle of incidence, and here it is 30 degrees. Now let's look closer at what is the angle of reflection, and that is the angle between OB and NO, and we can see that it's also 30 degrees exact. So not only did it look like the angles were always the same, they technically too were perfectly equal. But even though what I said is true, if you do the experiment with a regular mirror, chances are that it will not be a technically perfect experiment. And I will explain why as a part of the DIY project that we'll do at the end of the lesson. Laws of reflection. The first one is I is equal to R. So we saw the angle of incidence I is always equal to the angle of reflection, which is R. So I is equal to R. This will be true of multiple reflections as well. Another law of reflection, the incident ray, the reflected ray and the normal ray at the point of incidence are all in the same plane. This concept of same plane sounds confusing, but in our live experiment, you can see it very easily in the same setup. All I have to do is bring the camera from the top to the side and then bring it to the level of the same plane. All of them are in one line, they are in one plane. Here's another way to see this. All this is in one plane, along the sheet of the paper. Suppose it was not on the same plane, it would be something like this. Or like this. It would not be at one level or one plane. Regular and diffused reflection. Regular reflections is when parallel beams of light are reflected as parallel beams after hitting a polished or a mirrored surface, as you can see happening here. It's possible only on very polished surfaces because it requires all the particles on the surface to be in the same direction so that they reflect light in the same way. Here the angle of incidence and the angle of reflection of all the parallel rays remain the same following the laws of reflection. Examples of surfaces that cause regular reflection are mirrors, tinted glass, still water, polished marble and even metals and many other things. Diffused reflection is when parallel beams of incident light are reflected in seemingly random directions after hitting the surface. Here you can see it happening and you can see the rays break up so much that it just becomes a glow. It seems to break all the laws of reflection, but actually they're not breaking it. And to show that, I made this. This is what you could call a scaled up version of the surface, showing how the irregular surface will be. And this one is even bigger. The first one shows that the rays are bouncing off in random directions. But the second one helps to show that they don't reflect as parallel rays, but even though the reflections look random, each single ray of light still follows the laws of reflection. The angle of reflection of any single ray of light remains the same as the angle of incidence, but all the rays together don't remain parallel. So you don't see a reflection, but you see the object clearly, and all around us mostly are objects that cause this kind of diffused reflection. Now let's do a recap and move on to the DIY of the lesson. Sight and light. Humans have five senses: sight, hearing, smell, taste and touch. 80% of our sensory information is through sight, using our eyes. We see objects around us because of the presence of light. Objects can be luminous or non-luminous. Luminous objects generate their own light and therefore can be seen by themselves. Non-luminous objects don't generate their own light. They can only reflect light and therefore be seen only if there is some other source of light for them to reflect the rays. Reflection. Light is emitted from a luminous object as rays of light in all directions. A ray of light is a straight line path along which light travels. Three important terms to study reflection of light are incident ray, reflected ray and normal ray. Incident ray is the ray of light that hits any object. The point where it hits the object is called the point of incidence. The reflected ray is the ray of light that is reflected from the object. At the point of incidence, the normal ray or normal is the ray of light that is incident at 90 degrees or perpendicular to the surface. The angle of incidence is the angle between the incident ray and normal ray. The angle of reflection is the angle between the reflected ray and the normal ray. Laws of reflection. The angle of incidence I is always equal to the angle of reflection R. The incident ray, the reflected ray and the normal ray at the point of incidence are always on the same plane. Regular and diffused reflection. Regular reflection is when parallel beams of light are reflected as parallel beams after hitting a polished or a mirrored surface. Regular reflection on a surface requires all the particles to be in the same direction. Diffused reflection is when parallel beams of incident light are reflected in seemingly random directions after hitting the surface. Diffused reflections from a surface is caused by the particles in the surface to be in different directions. The surfaces of most objects offer diffused reflection. For the DIY, I will show you a simple way to do all the experiments with the light rays that I showed in this lesson. Take a small mirror of about 8 cm by 3 cm and you need to stick it on a 1 cm or 2 cm wide and long strip of wood. I am using these ice cream stick lookalikes that one can get in a craft shop. If you have a longer stick about 24 cm long, It will be better and you'll later see why. Stick it with glue and hold it till it sets. Be very careful when using hot glue. Along the other long edge of the mirror, you need to stick a protractor. Make sure that the baseline or the 180 degree line of the protractor and the front of the mirror are in line. Glue them together, hold it till it sets. Now you need to glue more of the sticks to the earlier stick as shown. This is also to make the first stick longer, which is why I mentioned that if you have a longer stick, it will be better. All these green sticks have to be at the same level. Just to make the structure stronger, add one more stick that goes over all the sticks. Now you need a glass bowl that is around 20 cm in diameter. Be very careful while handling glass. Fill water almost to the top and then put very little milk in it and stir. Put a few drops of milk in the water because that will help you see the light beam later. This is similar to how you need smoke or dust in the air to see the rays of light inside a room. Put the structure in the bowl and now you can see why we made the structure using the wood strips. Make sure that the mirror is mostly inside the water and the center of the protractor is in the center of the bowl. This next part is very crucial. Make sure that the mirror is perfectly vertical or perpendicular to the ground or table. You can see that mine wasn't, so I added a piece of clay. You can add anything that you might find to adjust the angle if required. That's it. Now all you need is a regular red laser torch and you're good to start proving the different laws of reflection. Make sure you throw the light beam exactly at the center of the protractor so that you can read all the angles accurately. You can see that the angle of incidence is always exactly the same as the angle of reflection as long as the beam points perfectly at the center of the protractor. Now I had mentioned in the lesson that if you use a regular mirror, then you will not get a perfect result. And you can see it here. The incident ray and the reflected ray don't seem to meet at the point of incidence. And you can see this problem even more from this angle. This is because in a mirror, the glass is in front and the mirroring or the reflective surface is behind the glass. So the rays will meet at that point and not in front of the mirror where we want to see it. For this, we stuck a reflective sheet on a sheet of plastic. This way the reflection is at the top surface of the sheet and therefore we get a single point. That's why we made and used this mirror in this lesson. Things required for the DIY project. Small piece of mirror, the size is given in the lesson. A protractor. A laser torch. A glass bowl with water. Milk, 1/4 tablespoon, ice cream sticks, 5, plasticine, and a glue gun. In this lesson, you saw single rays of light reflecting off a surface. In the next, we'll explore multiple rays and multiple reflections, and the excitement will multiply too. See you there.